Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week, it's the Hollywood Studios, year by year, and we begin a new decade, 1940, with our lead-off studio, as always, Paramount. We'll be talking about a pair of Akim Tamiroff films, and also a pair of Muriel Angelus films, in fact. We'll start out with The Way of All Flesh, and we'll conclude with The Great McGinty, Preston Sturges' debut as a director. We'll also have a segment near the end, in which we discuss our fear and movie going in Toronto exploits. We'll talk about the first two films of the Kinuyo Tanaka retrospective going on right now at the TIFF Bell Lightbox.
Free for members.
Yes. So we won't go into any depth there, so you don't have to worry about spoilers, but we'll just give a little teaser of some of our thoughts and some of the things that we've gathered based on our early experiences with this great director. We will be talking about all of her films in depth in 2028. It's on the schedule. You can look it up. But right now, let's talk about Paramount 1940, and that means we're going to look at Joel W. Findlay, once again, The Hollywood Story. His amazing charts showing all of the stars on the roster, and he's got his three-star system to rate their appeal on a marquee, as he sees it, during the length of their entire tenure at the studio.
Where do you think Akim Tamiroff and Brian Donlevy are going to come up?
Nowhere, sadly.
Is Brian Donlevy even a contract player at Paramount?
I think he is. Shows up at a lot of studios before and after this period, but he does become something of a star. Here are the people that Findlay lists.
Findlay's list.
God. We start out with Bing Crosby, 3 stars. Monarch of Paramount. Ray Milland, 3 stars. Fred McMurray, 3 stars. Dorothy L'Amour, 2 stars. Bob Hope, 3 stars. Gary Cooper, 3 stars. Barbara Stanwyck, 3 stars. She wasn't at Paramount for all that long here, but 1939 to 1941. Claudette Colbert, 3 stars. Susan Hayward, 1 star. Paulette Goddard, 3 stars. William Holden, 1 star. So both Hayward and Holden would go on to much greater acclaim in the 1950s, but by then they were long gone from Paramount, so that doesn't factor into their meager 1-star rating. Now, Tamiroff was definitely under contract
yes.
here, but he was considered an ace character actor, and it just so happens that he got a chance to kind of star in Great McGinty and really star in The Way of All Flesh, which we're going to start with. First off, I'll read the dismally short review from John Douglas Eames' The Paramount Story. All of these coffee table books for the studios that I've assembled, that I read from every Hollywood Studios year by year episode, they've got entries on 20 to 30 of the bigger movies, and then they end with a little section with one sentence descriptions of the films, and sadly, Way of All Flesh has fallen into that category for Eames, and so all he tells us about it is, bank messenger is fleeced of securities and becomes a derelict, believed dead by his family. Remake of 1927 film. That's it. He does tell us the list of stars, which I'll read off. Akim Tamiroff, Gladys George, Muriel Angelus, William Henry, and it was directed by Louis King.
Who is the brother of Henry.
The more famous of the Kings, but Louis was prolific, directing many B films.
Lots of westerns.
Yeah, westerns and I guess some child star vehicles.
Mm-hmm.
A few other things. This, clearly a B film.
Well, I guess it's the only chance Tamiroff was going to get to be the lead.
And Gladys George. I love both of these actors, and it was a joy to discover them together at the top of a cast list.
We've had occasion to talk about Gladys George before.
Yeah, recently, because she's a big part of the success of the Roaring Twenties.
Yeah. This film really made a strong case for screenwriter, or not even screenwriter, story source as auteur.
Jules Furthman.
Yeah, Furthman's fingerprints are all over the place. He actually co-wrote the story with
Laios Biro.
So the one it particularly reminded me of was Blonde Venus.
Yeah, there's an element of that for sure. The estranged parent.
The rise and fall, the fairy tale quality, the sense at times that it's being told through the son's perspective, an older son in this case, somewhat older than Dickie Moore. So it makes a strong case for the story source as auteur, but also a strong case for the director as auteur, because this isn't a masterpiece. However, it was well worth watching. Blonde Venus is a masterpiece. I think it's definitely very high on our list of favorites of the Sternberg-Dietrichs.
What about screenplay auteur? Because Lenore Coffey wrote this screenplay, and I found it interestingly similar in its early scenes to Four Daughters, the way that starts off, with barking but loving father and a bunch of kids trying his gruff act, but really he's a softie. Now, Claude Rains in that film does not wind up in the kind of trouble that Akim Tamiroff does, but I think it kind of sets the scene in a similar way. And of course, all of that is Lenore Coffey, because nothing in the movie has anything to do with the story, which I have read.
Yeah, the Fanny Hurst story, you mean.
Right, which is called Sister Act, and which is another Grand Guignol maniacal descent into hell.
Knowing that Jules Furthman was involved, and therefore thinking in my little brain about Sternberg, couldn't help but watch this movie thinking of Emiliani. In fact, I wondered if some of it, like, it was faintly inspired by The Last Laugh. Pretty sure he has an important gold watch in that. Maybe I'm wrong, though. It's been a very long time since I saw The Last Laugh. But anyway, I thought about Yawnings, and it turns out that Yawnings was, in fact, in the silent film, of which this is a remake, but that film's apparently lost. However, if you go on Wikipedia, look at the poster for it, Yawnings has this fantastically evil expression on his face with two children sitting in his lap. So I do think a Yawnings version of this film could potentially be very different, and he can play pathetic characters, like in The Last Laugh. He can certainly bring the pathos, but might have also had a nastier side. It's kind of interesting that that nasty side is completely absent from Tamiroff's performance, despite the theme of the film, which we'll have to discuss what we think that is. I also wondered if Furthman and his co-writer were thinking of Hawthorne's Wakefield or similar stories to that.
Yeah, Enoch Arden, Little Fables, Tennyson, all these stories about people who disappear for huge amounts of time and then either actually reappear or sort of hover around the edges of a story, and the audience knows that they're there, but maybe the people that they're missing never find out, as in fact is the case here.
This is a Christmas movie.
It does all lead to a pretty intense Christmas sequence.
We didn't realize that going in. We love Christmas movies. Of course, I also wondered if the final scenes, if Coffey was thinking of Stella Dallas.
Had to be, yeah.
So it's very much a male melodrama. So we decided to actually look up Wakefield, because neither of us could remember if Wakefield, who disappears from his, like, he's just an ordinary, unremarkable guy who just decides to disappear from his ordinary, unremarkable life, and particularly his wife and home, one day as a sort of merry jape, and then 20 years later decides to return. And Hawthorne doesn't actually tell us what happens after he decides to come in from the rain to his warm hearth and wife. But the final paragraph here, this to me seems like it is like Furthman and or Lenore Coffey had to be thinking of this last paragraph in particular when they crafted this story. Hawthorne says, "Amid the seeming confusion of our mysterious world, individuals are so nicely adjusted to a system, and systems to one another, and to a whole, that, by stepping aside for a moment, a man exposes himself to a fearful risk of losing his place forever. Like Wakefield, he may become, as it were, the outcast of the universe." Hawthorne's tone is much less sentimental than the tone of this movie, and yet somehow still, maybe by the fairy tale qualities of the story, somehow still this message is communicated, because it doesn't make any sense psychologically, and it doesn't make any sense morally, the story.
No. Hawthorne is very perverse.
No, but I mean the Way of All Flesh movie story. That's what I'm talking about. To me, it doesn't make any sense psychologically or morally, and it doesn't have to because it's a fairy tale. The fairy tale has this point just about what happens to you when you become removed from your system. It just occurred to me now as well, because there's actually a reference to this movie in the Sturges film, The Great McGinty, which is the first film that he directed.
We're going to be talking about that a lot. These films are intimately linked.
And The Great McGinty has a very intimate link to Sturges' The Miracle of Morgan's Creek. So it does make me wonder if The Miracle of Morgan's Creek has its source in this movie too. I mean, one of its sources. In which case, the movie would be inspired by movies by both King brothers. And we are the only ones who haven't covered this.
Possibly.
But we'll talk about what those connections are when we talk about the second movie.
The other way you can take the Hawthorne-er text is the way that Dashiell Hammett took it in his interpolated story in The Maltese Falcon, the Flitcraft fable.
Right.
That Sam Spade just decides to regale his guests with while they're waiting for the falcon to show up. He tells of a man that he was hired to find in Seattle or Portland. I forget which was the original town. And he never found him until many years later he finds him in the other town, Portland or Seattle. The guy did have this weird whim, abandons his whole family, disappears without a trace, turns up just by chance Spade runs into him again, and he's living the exact same life with a family that is completely indistinguishable from the first family. And he has a big talk with Flitcraft about this, and Flitcraft says, yeah, well, I had this huge revelation when a beam happened to fall right next to me and nearly crushed me, and I went crazy, I left, I figured I have to seize the moment, I have to do everything that a human being can possibly do before I expire. And then he realized no other beams were going to fall, and he falls comfortably into his rut once again. It's obviously a much less pathos-laden story than The Way of All Flesh, because he recreates his system pretty much immediately and at will as soon as he decides that he wants to.
Yeah, and I don't think it's through lack of wanting to do that that Akim Tamiroff's character becomes the outcast of the universe. It's just that there is, in fact, not any way back. In Blonde Venus, and who knows if this is Sternberg's influence, the way back is through the imaginative will of the child, who turns out to be the underlying perspective of the movie.
The god of that universe.
We don't get any such deus ex machina here.
No. Also, we really do spend enough time with Tamiroff and his family that we see the real connections, the real feelings he has for this particular group of people. It's not just a placeholder family for him.
No, not at all.
He's pretty stuck on them.
And that makes the movie even crueler.
It does, of course.
And you were talking about Coffee and Four Daughters, because what this shares with that movie is an encounter between a bourgeois world of physical and emotional comfort and a noir world of senselessness and tragedy and exile and loneliness.
Yeah. It's got some similarities as well with the 1945 film Scarlet Street, in which a watch for distinguished service figures heavily.
It's 1940, and this movie doesn't get talked about as a proto-noir, but it certainly is.
I think so, right? And that movie ends with a derelict Edward G. Robinson, who's done much worse things than Tamiroff has done here. All he's done is fallen for the wiles of a big city dame and lost a bunch of money. He's wandering in the wilderness forever.
There is, of course, also a certain similarity to William Wyler's Carrie.
Yeah, definitely.
Shall we get into the texture of the movie a little bit?
Small town Pennsylvania.
First indication of who these people are we get is the wife, Gladys George, telling the milkman, is it? Not to speak Hungarian to them because they are American. So this is our first introduction to the tone and the tenor of this family and the world they occupy.
So they're committed to assimilation. Right? Gladys George, we don't really know her background. She married Tamiroff, but Tamiroff obviously has a thick accent. He is a first generation.
Well, but this guy is talking Hungarian to her, so.
She may also be Hungarian, but she's much better at taking on the American accent in that case. But she says, my husband hates it. He doesn't like hearing that. We're Americans. We'll talk English. It doesn't seem to bother her.
Right.
So it's something about Tamiroff and wanting to be.
This is a pretty important character detail.
Yeah.
They are committed to assimilation, upward mobility, and respectability. But there's, as we see, emotion behind these things.
Sure, of course. Well, it is the route to the good life in America at that time, right? If you can assimilate, you can acquire all of the wonderful bourgeois comforts that this family has. And he has risen in the bank to become the cashier.
They're committed to health, orderly bodies, as well as orderly morals. We see him, for the first time, leading the exercises of his children.
And they've got a sing-song rhyme that will become very poignant later on.
Von Trapp kids.
Yeah, they do. He is the patriarch, but again, he's the kind of ideal of the patriarch, rather than the nightmare version that we usually get in films and stories, where it's all about authority. You know, he really does seem to be trying to use his authority to do something good for his kid.
He favors one child in particular.
Well, he does. Yes.
Who is the nascent artist, and he is not, as you often get in these immigrant stories. Well, I don't know if that's true, because I'm thinking about Humoresque.
Paul Bourré.
Like, this made me wonder if Tamiroff's background in Hungary, if he had maybe been a musician before he settled down to try to raise this family in America. We don't ever hear about that, though.
There's music in the family, because Gladys George plays the piano accompaniment for her son.
Right. Is there some background where they met as musicians? But no, we hear his whole backstory. He's been working in this bank all his life.
Yeah, since he was 10.
Like, so if he gave up a musician's life, it was as a child.
Right, and it was to build a bourgeois bubble in which an artist could flourish.
Thinking of Humoresque, in that immigrant family, the husband is against the son becoming a musician, isn't he?
Yeah, because they want him to do something practical.
Yeah. So you often get that story. But here, no, the father is such a benign patriarch that he loves the idea of one of his children becoming an artist.
Yeah, and he does favor that child, but he's still pretty nice to everyone. It's not like he picks on everybody else.
But we get an important moment when he's called on this favoritism at the breakfast table.
And he realizes, yeah, this is not right. This is not the patriarch's job. I must be impartial. I must administer justice wherever it is required.
But he tells a big lie here. He tries to fool his wife.
Takes his son into the other room and pretends to give him
a horrible beating.
I mean, I guess pretty much standard for the time, right? But of course, he's not actually hitting him. He's hitting a chair.
And when the wife discovers this, like, you have to start asking yourself, who is actually in charge of the morality in this family? Is it? It seems to be him. He seems to be in charge of doling out discipline.
Yeah, but she's the ultimate arbiter.
Well, yeah, she's the one who indicated that he needed to do this. And then she's the one who tries to intervene. And finally, she is the one who not only gives a more measured punishment to the son, but also gives a punishment to her husband for lying.
No cigar for you today.
And he, we learn, is such a good man. He's so committed to morality that he, several times throughout the day, stops himself from having a cigar, even though she's not there to observe him.
Yeah, he could sneak a cigar anytime he wants, but he won't. It's really good. I really like the way they put this family together for us. It gives you something to think about the rest of the film.
They have to establish this world in order to introduce the contrasting one, and of course that is what she does so well in Four Daughters, that some people even mourn the loss of the idyllic world we're presented with initially, when sure. John Garfield appears. Yeah, then we find out how the bank works, and the bank is also idyllic. This is a very nice bank run by very nice people. This is not anything he needs to chafe against or rebel against.
No, it's not a scathing satire of bourgeois American life. We can say that for sure. Unlike a lot of noir, which usually is.
That's one of the unique qualities of this film.
Yeah, so he's been rewarded for his service. He has moved up the ranks, and we could see on the bank that...
Actually, you know, this is proving my thesis, because the whole speech he gives to the adult clerk about how you have to be respectable to work in a bank, that is used by Sturges.
Of course, Mr. Twerk says it to Eddie Bracken, Norval.
My God, we've really uncovered something here. This movie was really important to Preston Sturges.
Oh, I think so.
Whether he realized it or not.
No, I think this is a secret source of much Sturgian inspiration. So,
and this is the Sturges, of course, who pretended that he didn't know that any female screenwriters worked in Hollywood at the time, other than being brought on board for little romantic scenes.
So So at the bank, we see on the window, the frosted letters show us quite clearly, if you don't know what a cashier is, and I don't know if I knew exactly, it's beyond just the person that's at the, it's not a teller, right? It's like the head of all of the disbursement of funds. So it is a very responsible role, and he's third billed, right? There's the president, the vice president, and the cashier. Those are the people that are on the window. So it's no mean achievement for someone with presumably no real education, started at 10 and just moved up the ranks.
And we hear about this because he then deals with the young boy who seems to be, what is he, printing money? What is he doing there? He's running some kind of machine that looks like it's printing something.
I don't know.
I don't know what he's doing, but this boy, the youngest employee of the bank, he deals with him very differently than he deals with the adult man, who he basically fires.
Yeah, pretty much. Obviously, we get the sense that this is a long time coming, right? That there have been many incidents. It's not like one strike and you're out for Tamiroff here. This is, okay, this guy, he just keeps screwing up. He keeps making the bank look bad in the town.
And hang on. Isn't Song of Bernadette also 1940?
No.
Okay, never mind. What year is it?
43.
Oh, way later. I'll take that out then.
So, yeah, that guy who is actually the genial doctor in Miracle on 34th Street, that's how I know him. So I was a little shocked to see he's supposed to be a waste in this film.
Dissipated bank teller.
Yeah. So yeah, it's true. At this point, Tamiroff thinks he should leave the bank. But yeah, this 14-year-old kid who really has stolen some money from the bank, only 50 cents, with the intention of replacing it. He does not deal harshly with him. He uses it as a teachable moment and no one will know about it. Tamiroff replaces the 50 cents and he shows him his watch and he inspires him with the idea that, you know, you too could become a respectable pillar of the community if you just keep your hand out of the till.
And we later learn that, well, this worked, at least up until his young adulthood. We don't know if this boy is going to completely repeat the trajectory of Akim Tamiroff's character.
Ah, well.
Or are we supposed to take this as a sign of the kind of generosity and forgiveness he can extend to another person, but not to himself?
Well, yeah, that's true too. And there's a really key moment that you might miss if you're not watching for it. And I don't say I was watching for it, but I had a sense of what the story was about. And so that, it really stood out. When they see the ne'er-do-well teller come into the restaurant with a woman, and Tamiroff immediately says, you know, that's not a good woman he's with. A man can tell, right? So obviously there's no eternal wisdom in that statement, but he's really telling us a lot about his psychology there. He's saying, I'm dreadfully terrified of meeting a woman who's going to talk me into doing something evil. And he was right to fear that, because it certainly happens. You remember that scene?
No. Oh, it doesn't matter. So this restaurant scene is quite important that you brought up, because that's the scene where the son plays the song, which seems to signify the shift into the other world, and occurs again later in the film.
Yeah.
The playing of the father's favorite song, which is a very pretty, sentimental, familiar song. I wish I knew what it was called, but it's certainly one I've heard before.
Yeah, I feel like we could find it, but I just don't know what it is.
Well, yeah, there's not enough information about this movie online.
No. Son shows that the father's faith in him is not misplaced. I mean, he is a good, he's clearly some kind of budding musical genius. He plays this perfectly in front of a big audience at the restaurant, and it's only going to get better and better from here.
So this is one version, I guess, of who this father is, the man who's going to sit and listen to his budding genius son play his favorite sentimental song, and all is right in the universe, and the bourgeois family is at its apex, and they're about to climb even higher, actually, with this phone call that arrives.
Yeah, he gets a call. It seems like, oh boy, something bad's happened. And he takes off, but he comes home and he's just delighted because, no, nothing was wrong at all. There's actually a huge errand to New York City that must be undertaken, and he's the only one that can be trusted with this $100,000 security for an esteemed customer.
And of course, as soon as you hear that he's personally carrying $100,000 in securities, you know that something something dreadfully bad is going to happen.
It's not a safe thing to be entrusted with that kind of money.
And this is where the wife tells him, oh, well, look at this. Look at how much they're trusting you. One day you may become the president of the bank.
She really has to impress that upon him, because when she says, you know, the president may be retiring soon, and he just says, yeah, I wonder who will be my boss then. She foresees greater things, even greater things for him. He's not really thinking about that.
True. But once she mentions it, he does consider that it could be possible. I guess in this small town bank, maybe that is possible. If he just shows that he's the right kind of man.
Yeah. So he goes to New York, but unfortunately he just is not built for the big city.
Well, he is the victim of a vast conspiracy to take these securities away.
Yeah, and it's not like a noir in the sense that he actually gets talked into doing something really evil other than being attracted to a woman who's not his wife.
It feels very evil, though, after what we've seen, to find him so easily flirting with this other woman.
It's true.
Seeing not only of his relationship with his wife, who he of course calls Mama, but also his relationship with his children, and simply the morality that he's tried to impress on everyone. Now, I could see in an Emil Yanning's film, although not necessarily, but the film is lost, so we'll never know, all of this being made to seem more hypocritical, like all of this morality is just hypocrisy, and that would make more psychological and moral sense of the movie. The fact that it's not given to us that way forces the movie back on this sheer fairy tale logic or illogic. And the only sense that I can make of it is this idea that the world of bourgeois comfort is an enchanted space, and once you lose your place in it through a little fall, you lose your place in it forever. Then there is never a way back to the enchanted space. There's only looking on at it, longingly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so he shows up in New York, and he certainly has every intention of fulfilling his mission. But he's met at the station immediately by a person who seems like a Wall Street type guy, who explains that the important client has been delayed.
And he's far too naive to question any of this.
No, he goes for lunch. They start plying him with booze. A lot of talk about banking matters. And they bring over Muriel Angelus. She's pretending to be a bank journalist and flatters him that way at the beginning.
Right. She wants an interview, a human interest interview story with him. It's going to be so important for her career.
And again, we've seen that awakened this ambition in him started when his wife mentioned he might be president.
Right.
And here, this is just adding to it, this idea that, hey, maybe I am really important.
I wonder if Lenore Coffey is thinking of Mr. Deeds in this dynamic.
Yeah, that's an archetype, except that she's not a journalist, right? She's in Mr. Deeds, Jean Arthur is pretending to be a damsel in distress, but she's actually a journalist. Here, this is a femme fatale pretending to be a journalist.
A journalist in distress.
Exactly. It's very interesting. Things just move along, and the guy just gets caught in this web of flattery, obviously illicit attraction to this woman, Muriel Angelus.
But it really is deeply distressing to watch this.
It is, because he doesn't ever start to seem like a villain here, right? And you just feel like, oh no, it's like he's sneaking the cigar here.
Yeah, but he didn't sneak the cigar.
I know, but now he's too far away from home, and he is sneaking the cigar. He's trying to sneak the cigar into Muriel Angelus. And of course, he's getting hammered, which can impair moral judgment. But he never goes that step, right, where you see often in a movie like this, it becomes, oh, why don't you just run off with me, and we'll use the money to get married, etc., right? None of that happens. All that happens is he tries to kiss her in a bar until he gets too drunk and passes out, and then they rob him.
Yeah.
So he never turns on the bank.
No, I mean, his betrayal is to his wife and children, not to the bank.
Right.
And to his own sense of morality.
Well, definitely that. I mean, he's failed completely there. When he comes to the next morning, I mean, he immediately fights to get the money back. Of course, that's a big fail.
His life will be destroyed if he doesn't get that money back. How's he going to explain this? His marriage and his job will be destroyed.
That doesn't work out. They decide to kill him. Maybe it was always their intention. I don't think so, though. I think they were just going to pass him off as a shady guy that gave his money away to women in the darkness of the night. When he starts making all this trouble, they decide, okay, we're gonna have to kill him now. So they take him to the railroad tracks. Things go a little bit awry there, and the wrong person dies according to the gang's scheme, and he escapes. But escapes to what? Nothing. This also lays the groundwork for some of the stuff in Sullivan's Travels. Very similar incident on the train train tracks. Switching of identity, apparent death. It goes in a much more benign direction in the Sturges film, because eventually Sullivan is redeemed, comes back to his family, and revealed to be alive. But here, it's the end for the identity of Paul Kritza.
Yeah, and also, this movie shares with The Great McGinty the idea of, you know, going from this identityless state of bum to, well, actually going to a much higher pinnacle in The Great McGinty.
And then back again.
And here in this movie, instead, we just get the descent into nobodiness. That's also what Sullivan is attempting to do in Sullivan's Travels.
Yeah, I mean, he could have taken a lesson from Paul Kritza, because he succeeds completely.
And he actually seems to be talked into the idea that he is not himself by these bums.
Like, you can't be an important guy. Look at you.
And so this is where the shift into the other world is complete. Like, because he's had this moral failing, because he's acted out of character and it's had all of these consequences, now there's a sense in which he really isn't who he was anymore. Not socially and not psychologically.
But in a disturbing way that the film does draw attention to, he kind of achieves his apotheosis in this death.
And what Sturges film does that remind you of? This fake heroism?
Well,
that he achieves.
Hail the Conquering Hero.
It's all here, I swear to God.
This is the Ur-text.
The Ur-Sturges.
Because not only does he get his picture prominently in the paper the way they were pretending they were going to do when he meets Muriel Angelus, but he also just becomes a renowned hero to his town and to the eastern United States, probably, it seems like.
And that becomes maybe the main reason that he doesn't feel able to return, tell his story, come clean and return.
Right, of course, because it would ruin everything. It would undermine the entire foundation laid upon his grave by his wife.
And then the wife makes this speech to the children and also has them, I can't remember at what point she has them say their prayers and hope for daddy's return. And then we get another speech after he's died. And anyway, the atmosphere in all of these scenes with the mother turns her into this fairy tale character, an angel presiding over this enchanted world that he can never re-enter.
Of course, she has no way of knowing that he's still out there. She's just trying to make the best of what happened.
Yeah, realistically, that's what she's doing. But I don't feel that these scenes are heavy on the realism.
Well, she's cast a spell that he would break if he returned.
The spell is, we see more than ever once he's left, that the mother is this home. That the mother is the feeling of this home, and the mother is what he has rejected and lost and given up.
Yeah.
So in a way, it's a film about losing a father that's simultaneously, from his perspective, about losing a mother. And maybe that's why he calls her Mama.
Maybe.
I mean, it's all there in Blonde Venus.
Yeah. So the rest of the film is mostly about him moving shiftlessly through the Great Depression.
He is like a child. That's how Tamiroff plays it. This character and the way that he takes her orders and agrees to not have the cigar. He is like one of her children, and he becomes one of her lost children.
Yeah, he has no impulse control. He knows that, and that's why he's so critical of the bank teller hanging out with a woman of dubious morals, because he knows what happens. If you meet one of those, wrap you around their finger, and that's it. He's not going to resist, and it won't even be out of malice. It'll just be because he's just too formless without his wife around. He doesn't seem dissatisfied with his life at all. But
he's not.
Yeah, exactly.
He's not. It's not like he has any additional impulses that he needs to release in the other world. It's not about that.
No, it's just he turned down the wrong path. He was sent down a dangerous road by the bank.
Just wasn't capable of handling it.
And that scene, well, there are a couple of poignant scenes, but for me, Tamiroff, his finest hour is when he is at the park.
The park where he's watching, I mean, he seems to have some kind of little job picking up trash. He's watching children do exercises on the other side of a fence, and that's where I first started putting together this idea of this world that he's been exiled from and how he can now never return to it, can only stare at it from a distance.
Yeah, and he repeats the rhymes from the beginning of the film. Good for Victor, good for Paul, exercise is good for all. And it's so mournful. It's so well done. A policeman comes over, asks him if he has any kids, and he says, no, I have nobody. wanders off again. Then he realizes he sees a newspaper trumpeting the arrival of Paul Kritza Jr. in New York City. He's been on a European tour. He has thrilled the crown heads of Europe. Now, World War II has started because it's explicitly 1940 at this point. So no more concerts in Europe. Time to come back to America where there are fewer bombings and play for the home folks. And he goes to watch his son achieve everything that he ever hoped for. Standing ovations, and we find out that the son is headed back to the small town in Pennsylvania to spend Christmas with the family that Tamiroff has been exiled from. And so he goes back there too.
And I mean, at this point, the audience is just left wondering, will he find his way back and how? And I think we're tempted, given the tone of this movie and the fact that it's a Hollywood movie, to think that he will somehow.
Well, yeah, of course. That's
like, none of this has seemed like a heavy enough drama to end the way that it does.
Really interesting, right? Because he did not commit any criminal offenses. He doesn't have to be punished in terms of the code.
He was robbed.
Yeah. He flirted with a woman that he shouldn't have, that's for sure. Maybe that's enough. I'm not sure if the code insisted on him not getting his family back, but that doesn't seem right because there are plenty of families that come back together after this kind of escapade in other films. But no, here he's peeping through the window. The Cossacks are ready to take him off to jail, but again, his charming best case scenario bourgeois family comes to the rescue. They are not vindictive. They don't want to punish the outsider. They want to bring him in.
And the little boy who he saved from the retribution of the bank, or, you know, or of becoming morally corrupt, is now marrying one of the daughters, right?
Yeah, and he is also on the path to success at the bank, right? He's not the cashier yet, because he's still a little young for that job, I guess, but he's probably going to be in the same role that his idol had.
And of course, we do wonder if history will just repeat itself in that case.
Well, maybe, yeah. And Gladys George gives him the watch, which is a very impactful scene as well. Again, he says, well, shouldn't one of his real sons have it? And she says, no, he would have wanted you to have it. You're the one who's taken up his mantle at the bank.
Or does this gentle correction that he had mean that he never will stray? Was that his moment of temptation and he was forgiven?
Yeah, well, he got lucky. Paul Sr.
He waited too long, too late in life for that moment of temptation.
He's met up with the exactly wrong people at the exactly wrong time. And yeah, the movie ends with him wandering back into the night.
But he says he does have a family, a wonderful family.
Yeah. I mean, it's like the little match girl.
Well, and also like the ending of Carrie.
So, very good movie. Expertly assembled by a complete non-entity as far as auteurism is concerned. But I think it's well directed. It's beautifully acted. It's very well written and conceived. And it gave rise to all of Preston Sturges' films.
So I was just trying to find out any further information on The Way of All Flesh, and TCM notes says that the original silent film credited the story The Way of All Flesh by Pearly P. Sheehan as its literary source. So some of this stuff may have come from that, but I'm still feeling the Furthman touch, in spite of all of that, in the remake here.
So a totally unheralded film, one that everyone should see, one that everyone should seek out. If you can't find it, and you very well might not be able to, just let us know. We can help you. A movie that no one will have any trouble finding, however, is The Great McGinty, because it stands at the beginning of Preston Sturges' illustrious directorial career. I'm going to start with John Douglas Eames' write-up from the Paramount story. The studio rewarded Preston Sturges for his splendid scripts, and they cite Easy Living and Remember the Night, etc., by letting him take a crack at directing one of them. Something he had long wanted to do. The Great McGinty not only won him the 1940 Oscar for Best Original Screenplay, but had the critics throwing their hats in the air to celebrate the arrival of a dazzling new filmmaker. A broad satire on the way politics sometimes works in the USA, it detailed the rise of a dim-witted hobo pushed by a crooked wheeler-dealer, played by Akim Tamiroff, to the state governorship, and his eventual fall. It had the speed of a skyrocket and the sparkle of a Catherine wheel as it fired off its hilarious barbs in a series of tightly edited scenes involving William Demarest, Muriel Angelus, Thurston Hall, Steffi Duna, Louis-Jean Haidt, Esther Howard, Arthur Hoyt, Richard Carle, and Libby Taylor. Paul Jones produced economically. It is a short film, and they obviously didn't pour huge amounts of money into it, but it sure paid off in the long run.
Your friend there forgot to mention that this is the film that Sturges sold to Paramount for $10 on the condition that he be allowed to direct it.
Ah, yes. The great legend, and I guess the great truth.
So this is an interesting film to talk about right after our Lincoln episode, because we were trying to come up with famous movies about American politics. And we mentioned Capra, but we forgot to mention Sturges.
I was trying to think particularly about movies that focus on the legislative process, and we don't really get that here, but we certainly get a lot of musing about how the political system works.
Yeah, and very specifically about what that has to say about American society.
Right.
It definitely is a movie that doesn't think that the system can possibly work.
Not without severe overhauling, and it doesn't allow much hope for seeing a way that it could be overhauled.
Sturges and Capra are often opposed to each other, but I think they have a lot in common. And I think Sturges is every bit as sentimental as Capra is. I guess Capra isn't a satirist. I guess that would be a difference. But the difference is certainly not that Capra is corny and Sturges is not.
No, and Sturges loved Capra.
Yeah, but they are pitted against each other by people who want to hate Capra. Critics who want to hate or at least take Capra down a notch or something.
Right, or use him to...
Use him as a foil.
Complain about America writ large, which is reasonable. Everyone should be complaining about America and Canada and most other countries. So a lot of the pairing here is fortuitous. I mean, I picked them because I like the idea of doing two films that prominently feature Akim Tamiroff.
Yeah, how were you to know the deep intertwining of these two films and the rest of Preston Sturges' career?
I mean, some of it we intuited and we teased out, but right on the face of it, this movie starts out with a cashier who made a big mistake and is now exiled from home. So that is a direct reference to The Way of All Flesh.
Right, and then McGinty comes in with, oh, you think you had it bad. You think you had a fall into obscurity.
I was the governor of a state.
In other words, Sturges is being like, I can tell a better story than this great story that I liked so much.
So Louis-Jean Haidt, who is best known maybe to cineasts as Joe Brody in Hawks' version of The Big Sleep.
Right.
He turns up all over the place, but this might be his biggest role.
It's like a more solid Dan Duryea.
Yeah, much squarer. And less menacing looking, too. Less weaselly. He's more hapless looking. But he's getting hammered in a South American bar, pouring his guts out to a woman who has taken an interest in him.
Yeah, and she's an entertainer at the bar.
Yeah, so we get this extended introduction to the milieu in which the story will be told, but it has nothing to do with the real subject of the film, which is what goes on back in America. So all of these people are on the outside, not even looking in. They're just completely out. This guy has reached the point that we wonder how Tamiroff avoided. I guess it's just thinking about how wonderful his family is. That's what kept him from blowing his brains out, because he doesn't seem to be living for anything else. And Louis-Jean Haidt, despite the fact that he's much younger and he's got this entertainer that seems to want to date him, he still wants to kill himself because he's ruined his life. He made one mistake, and the movie has these parallels that it talks about even in the introductory scroll about a person who lived an upstanding life all the way until they made one mistake, and his opposite number, a person who just made nothing but evil decisions until one good decision forced him to leave the country as well. And that's the symmetry that brings these two together and generates the context for the story. Most of the rest of it, of course, is McGinty detailing his rise and fall. He's a hobo, a legitimate hobo, not someone just down on his luck who once was a great man or something like that, or a rich man, or anything. He just seems to have been in that state his entire life. All he knows how to do is connive a living one way or the other and fight. But he does have initiative. Election night allows scope for initiative, we discover. There's a soup kitchen where they'll give you a little sustenance and also direct you to another little encampment behind the soup kitchen where they are handing out instructions on how to get money in exchange for voting illegally.
Overseen by William Demarest.
William Demarest? So much of the Sturges stock company is here already.
Right, and the textual, on the face of it, link between this movie and Miracle of Morgan's Creek is that McGinty and...
The boss,
Tamiroff, reappear at the beginning of Miracle of Morgan's Creek.
Yeah, they've miraculously returned from the exile. They are running the state that Eddie Bracken lives in, moving heaven and earth to ensure that whatever brings in the most most money to the town and to the state is done and is made fiat.
So I have ideas about the connection of the two films, but first we have to get to where McGinty meets the boss.
Right, so he distinguishes himself by voting 37 times, which adds up to $74. And of course, they're only expecting one vote out of this. It is actually an interesting little peek behind the curtain of ballot stuffing and all the little tactics that democratic machines would avail themselves of in big cities in early 20th century America. This is just a perfect scheme. They've got someone at each polling station that will respond to the code, "Hey Bill." As soon as they hear that, they know, okay, well, I've looked over the voting rolls and I know here are some people that are not coming, either because they're not in town, they're dead.
They're Akim Tamiroff and they've just disappeared.
So why shouldn't the mayor get their votes just because they're dead? That's the logic of William Demarest. So it's not like they're creating completely new people and stuffing the ballot that way. No, they would never do that. There's a name there. Why not put a vote next to it? And so they do it. No one else has done what Dunleavy decides to do, which is go to every polling station in the city, it seems like, and comes back with all the tickets. Demarest can't pay him. He doesn't have enough money on hand. So he's got to bring him back to campaign headquarters, where the boss holds court. And this is, of course, Akim Tamiroff.
So the flavor in these scenes with Akim Tamiroff is so very, very Scorsese. Speaking of influences on later films, what is a political boss? Because he seems like a mafioso.
It's a related field of endeavor. He will focus, he's kind of the intermediary between the mobs and the...
And there's payouts. Just like in the mob.
Well, it's a protection racket. Yeah. But he's in a position to offer protection directly, right? Because he controls the municipal government. So it's not just, oh, I'm going to pay the gangs not to break my windows every day. I'm going to pay the boss so that the police don't hassle me
right. All
day long.
And we see, like, this movie introduces many, many members of Sturges' stock company. And the only woman who's in that stock company, we see Esther Howard, who is ostensibly a medium.
She's so good, always.
And also doing a completely different type of role in my favorite noir, Born to Kill. so good in that. So she's ostensibly a medium, but we learn in the course of the scene that she's actually a prostitute.
Well, I think she's both.
Well, yeah, she's both.
Yeah.
Yeah, she's just earning extra, definitely earning maybe the real money from prostitution.
Maybe, yeah.
Or just a little extra on the side, who knows?
Yeah, and she's quite interested in Dunleavy. That's the tryout job he gets. Going around collecting protection money from, you know, the real hold. Holdouts, the people that never pay.
And this is because he stands up to the boss, and the boss thinks this is very amusing. He even says at one point he thinks he's me.
Yeah, no, that's the punchline.
So there's a very, very close connection between these two. They are sort of doubles of each other.
Oh yeah, and they really like each other, despite the differences that emerge.
So James Harvey, I read James Harvey's chapters on Preston Sturges when I was researching my Sturges essay for Bright Wall, Dark Room, which is the last film essay I've written because my attention has gone elsewhere for the time being. Harvey really digs into, this is his romantic comedy. Is it from Lubitsch to Sturges? Is that what it is?
I believe so.
His romantic comedy book, the huge book. I only read the Sturges chapters. I've read other chapters at other times.
It's quite comprehensive.
He goes deep into this idea of Sturges' obsession with his stepfather and how that becomes various father figures in his films, and that this is one of the most important elements in Sturges' films. I think he goes a little too far with it, but absolutely it's a very important element in this film and in The Miracle of Morgan's Creek, which seems to be generated out of this film. In both cases, there's the idea, well, we'll come to that in the plot, but there's the idea of a father very lovingly caring for and protecting a family that's not his own, children that aren't his own, becoming a father to them.
Right.
You get two sets of fathers in this film, because Tamiroff is a father figure to Dunleavy.
And to the rest of the gang.
Well, particularly for our purposes, to Dunleavy, to McGinty. And then McGinty also becomes a father, and it's almost like a competition between, I think the wife is pretty much immaterial. as much as he tries to build the role up, she's not really, she's peripheral to the film. So it becomes like a competition between McGinty as father and McGinty as son, and I think McGinty as son wins. That's where I see the tug of war in this movie.
Yeah, I think that makes sense. So yeah, they develop this relationship, and he's the most competent man that the boss has come across in ages. And he says, we want to start playing this game a little less violently. I need some people on my staff that can go get money without shooting.
Yeah, this becomes a whole routine, a whole joke routine, where he is pointing to this slug, talking about how without a gun, he's nothing, right? Because he can't beat anyone up, basically. I need some muscle so that we don't have to just shoot everybody. I need some living customers.
And Brian Donlevy obviously does look like a tough guy.
Yeah.
Does a great job convincing in this role.
And insofar as there's a morality competition here between the boss and the wife, who is, well, Catherine's her name, Muriel Angelus, the opposite sort of influence as in the other movie.
Yeah, I thought this was a terrific showcase for Muriel Angelus, and it's pretty sad that these are her last two films. I looked her up a little bit. She's a British actress. She had a few roles in America, but she started out well, I think, in Britain, and she would give interviews later on saying it was a mistake to come across the Atlantic.
Yeah, she became a very small fish in a very large pond.
Yeah, but she's really good in these movies.
True.
I really liked her, especially in this.
Well, she's very funny in this.
Yeah, she's great.
She's got some real off-kilter rhythms.
Exactly. I mean, she's the wisecracking secretary and the morality outlining wife. It's very interesting.
We learn that she definitely comes from a wealthier background than he does. From an intellectual family, her father's some kind of author.
Yeah, you get some Sturges stuff that will be repeated in other films. You know, the idea that, oh, you want to go reform the tenements. The people in those tenements don't want to hear from you. They don't want anything from you. They just want to be left alone. It's the same thing you hear in Sullivan's Travels. Robert Grieg, the butler, says pretty much exactly the same thing. This seems to be Sturges' philosophy, or half of his philosophy anyway, that you can't do anything about poverty, and all you can do is don't be officious. Don't go in like a social worker and bother these people.
Maybe? I think we're left up in the air as to whether he's correct in that assessment.
Well, no, I'm not saying that he's right. I think he's wrong.
I think he would understand, though, Preston Sturges, who came from a very eccentric and wealthy background himself, that he doesn't know anything about this.
Well, exactly. But I'm just saying, he gets this into a few films, so it's part of his calculus. He's thinking about, okay, I too think we need to do something to make society fair for everyone. But on the other hand, are we just going to be resented if we come in like a bunch of out-of-touch liberals and start saying, oh, the way you're living isn't good enough?
Well, yeah, I mean, that's the whole impetus behind Sullivan's Travels.
Exactly.
This idea of how can a privileged person comprehend the lives of, you know, desperate people, poor people? How can they do that without just being completely presumptuous asses?
Yeah, patronized.
Insofar as there is a competition between the boss and the wife as centers of values, not morals, but values for McGinty. The boss makes his speech about how America is this wonderful land of opportunity for people like him. Comes from a place where everybody is just a war of all against all, and it's the same thing in America, except that, you know, if you're really good...
You can actually win something.
If you're really good at it, you will get ahead, right? Per idea. So it's basically, he is the criminal that McGinty admires because he basically is just this concentrated essence of the self-made American man, really. Right? Someone who is genuinely self-made, someone who genuinely comes from nothing, plays dirty just like everybody else, including the rich in America, and actually gets somewhere through his ambition.
Well, yeah, he's gotten where he is by managing to push around and influence and take money from the wealthiest segment of society, right? That's who he makes his deals with. People that own these huge corporations who want to operate without any fear of regulation, for lack of a better word.
So McGinty has great sympathy for him, but he also has sympathy for this out-of-touch liberal who wants to do things to improve this totally corrupt system within which the boss is succeeding.
Right.
You know, at like a sort of medium level.
It's a hard choice to make.
Well, I mean, it doesn't. The movie doesn't decide anything. It becomes totally irresolvable. It reaches a complete impasse, which is very Capra-esque.
Yeah, because it can't envision the land beyond where we are, right? Even Capra can't do that. All Capra can do is try to foster the will to change things in some way. But how would you do it? Not exactly easy to see. And I don't think any of us have figured it out yet.
No. And this movie is completely clear about that impossibility. It like just basically declares it is impossible. As soon as I decide that I'm going to use the power I've achieved with great difficulty to do something good, as soon as I make that decision, it will all be taken away from me.
Right, because any elected official, anyone with any amount of power in society, only has that power because it's good for the status quo. It's good for the structure, which is not controlled by anybody. It's just a vast shell game that enough people are willing to play along with that anyone that gets out of step with it is going to be out of luck.
Child labor, that's a fraught issue.
And you see it today, too. Anyone that proposes making all kinds of changes that seem like no-brainers, all of a sudden there's a lot of people that are up in arms against it. People that should be happy about it, that could be benefiting. But yes, in 1940, if you crack down completely on child labor, then the people who have sent their kids out to work all of a sudden have none of that money coming in. Why are the kids working? It's because those families have no money. So you can't just outlaw child labor without bringing in other ways of getting money to those families.
Right.
And that's the problem with the out-of-touch liberal who just wants to do one thing without doing all the things that are necessary to support that. And we see that all the time now too. So if you isolate one problem, then it becomes easy for people on the opposite side who have no good faith intention of using it against you and making it seem like you just want to do something even worse to these abused, oppressed people. You just want to make them starve even more than they're already starving, with their kids at home doing nothing.
Yeah, or he talks about being out on the street and, you know, learning bad words or whatever.
Yeah, that's what he said. It kept me from... I mean, it didn't seem to keep him out of that much trouble if he wound up in the state that he's in at the beginning of the film. But whatever he did learn, he learned from work, he says. And we loved it. We had fun.
Well, it is the Depression, as you said.
Yeah.
Maybe he'd have some kind of factory job if it weren't the Depression.
Could be.
So besides all of this, I mean, it's a messy and complicated movie. And besides all of this social analysis, whatever we think of it, there is this weird arranged marriage plot.
If you want to get elected, you got to have a wife.
But yeah, Sturges is just spinning this. It seems like a very intuitive movie, you know? It's like it's not any kind of obvious structure, any kind of obvious plot at all. It seems that he's just like spinning this fantasy out of his own emotional memory. And so he comes up with this idea of this woman with these children and trying to line McGinty up in the most awkward and artificial way possible with this potential family.
Yeah, because McGinty says, "Oh, you want me to get married? Forget it. I'll just stay an alderman then."
Maybe he is a kind of Mr. Deeds or anti-Mr. Deeds or something in Sturges' mind because he has this weird asexuality about him initially.
Well, that's true. Yeah, he's just not interested in any of that. And he's got this Jean Arthur type who is totally in the know. And she's got the most amazing formula for proving that graft doesn't exist. Because even if you rob the people, you give it back to them by spending all the money that you exploited from them.
Which, of course, has actually been proved untrue. The rich don't spend enough to justify what they earn.
No, they're hoarding everything and sending it overseas, so it doesn't work. But it sounds good.
Yeah.
And of course, grafters like it. I mean,
if it did work, that would be, you know, not perfect, but better.
Well, and it was one of the arguments... And one of the arguments you might still hear for how Tammany Hall and political machines actually ran things better than whatever we've got right now, right? Because patronage was a way of redistributing wealth. So these gangs of Tamiroffs running all the cities would skim all kinds of money off of businesses and bankers and everyone else that wanted to have a free hand for their own schemes, but they had to pay handsomely for it. And they'd take all that money and roll it into hiring all their friends and all the people that vote for them to as many municipal jobs as they could create. So it was a jobs program, and right, that's why people supported the Democratic Party in all these cities, even though the policies it stood for were often very hard to even figure out. it wasn't really about that. It was about, okay, this is an organization that takes care of the people in its community, and it really was perceived that way.
Right, and
it did do enough of it for it to actually seem true.
We recently talked about another film about this, specifically, which was John Barrymore film, which is called The Great Man Votes, which makes you wonder if this is yet another film that influenced Sturges.
Well, in my Leonard Maltin guide, and I'm going to be putting up these reviews as well on our Discord, it is the next film, Great Man Votes, and right after it, alphabetically, comes The Great McGinty.
Yeah, Sturges tried out a few different names for this, but who knows if this wasn't the decisive thing for him or maybe for Paramount. Well, it wouldn't really be for Paramount because that was not a successful movie.
No.
The Great Man Votes is probably the kind of thing that would interest Sturges.
Oh yeah, I'm sure he saw that. I'm sure he loved it.
So, I mean, we've already kind of spoiled the conclusion here, which is that the rivalry between these two centers of values comes about, and we get, you know, some texture to this relationship, mainly in the form of him caring for these children. The presence of the children is one of the most crucial things about the relationship for him ultimately, and it does cause him to, like, personally reform and quit coming home drunk at all hours.
Oh, there's some really beautiful scenes in here, you know? A scene where he's really destroyed the house. And yeah, it does acquire more dimension when you realize that he's not that much of a bore. It's just that he didn't realize there would be any furniture in that room, because there wasn't when he left the house that day.
And this is, like, very early Sturges slapstick, too.
Yeah, he just keeps breaking more stuff. She comes out.
Oh, Mr. McGinty!
She escorts him back to the room, and when the kids see him in there, you know, he's very mild. He's a very mild drunk. Just sits there and says, oh, I'm so sorry the kids had to see me like this. I mean, it's just not what you expect.
Yeah, none of this stuff needs to be here for theme or plot or anything else. It's just, like I said, the texture of a writer just letting themselves spin whatever comes to them, basically. Yeah, whatever's meaningful to them.
Yeah, and it just makes him a very likable character. All of that stuff with the kids and with Muriel Angelus.
But all of that gets wrested away from him, this artificial family that he finally finds his way to.
She tells him, you know, bide your time then. If you don't think you can do it now as the mayor, one day you're going to be strong enough and you're just going to be able to buck the system. FDR but, style, a little bit, anyway.
But not at all, because he is much too closely tied to his double, the boss.
Oh, yeah. Well, when he becomes governor, she says, this is the moment. And he's like, are you sure? She says, yes, I'm sure. You can do it. And he's like, all right, let's do it. And he gets really into it. And he goes to see the boss on the day of his election. And the boss starts talking about all these amazing projects they're going to undertake, none of which have any real benefit to the people.
I mean, we would take this sort of thing now. They're at least paying some kind of attention to infrastructure, which is decaying in major cities these days.
Well, sure, of course. However, the way that they're going to do it promises to be a lengthy and far too expensive process. And that's what you do get in a lot of cities, right? Construction that seems to take 5 years for a job that could have taken much less time. It's just really spread out and everyone's benefiting except for the people that want to use the roads. But they don't go into that. They don't actually say that they're going to do that. So I don't know. Maybe they were a lot more efficient in the old days.
Well, there's a lot of talk about how great dams are because you never have to stop putting money into them.
Yeah. And Tamiroff goes back to that at the beginning of Miracle of Morgan's Creek, because when he hears the word creek, he thinks of river, and then he immediately thinks of, can we build a big dam on it? A little river, a big dam.
And of course, a dam plays a very important role in...
Will it creek dam?
Mr. Smith Goes to Washington.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, it's always a major node of graph, a dam.
So yeah, but he just goes down.
Yeah, well, he says, no, we're not doing any of that. Forget it. The whole program, throw it out.
And he has it long before Howard Hawks's Red River. He has his second affectionate wrestling match with the boss.
Yeah.
Or third, or I've lost count by this point.
I mean, this one, the stakes are a little higher because, yeah, they tussle, but then the boss does pull out a gun, tries to shoot him.
Right, and he won't press charges. This becomes a subject with his wife, even though the boss could go down for 20 years. But then right after that, I mean, pieces of his past are strategically revealed.
Yeah, well, that's obviously the boss's escape hatch, right? Or his revenge, anyway. If any moves are made against him, he unleashes all of the evidence against his co-conspirators, and they all go down with him. They're all in jail, but thankfully for them, William Demarest isn't. And here he poses as a constable. He will later embody that role in Miracle of Morgan's Creek.
Yep. try his best to get Eddie Bracken out of that jail. Yeah, it's not easy.
He's quite successful here, though. I mean, he spirits them out of there with no harm done, no gunplay needed, and they run for the border.
And there's a very poignant scene where he bids farewell to his fake family. However, he doesn't seem terribly unhappy in his new way of life with his other family.
Yeah, he's adjusted once again.
He loves the boss.
He does, yeah. And that's the big reveal, of course, at the end. Like, maybe you could see coming, but I'm not sure if I did the first time I saw it. Did they all stayed together. The entire gang stayed together and is running this nightclub, wherever it is.
So the exile is definitely not as devastating as it is in The Way of All Flesh.
Oh no, that's true.
So what I see is, in Miracle of Morgan's Creek, is Sturges kind of putting together this story of the lost father, the lost fake father, with something that's a lot closer to the disappearance and return, although incomplete return, of The Way of All Flesh, to create Eddie Bracken's trajectory in Miracle of Morgan's Creek, which actually becomes very, very poignant and very sort of magical and fairy tale-like. His disappearance and return.
Yeah, and McGinty and the boss are complicit in effecting that fairy tale ending. They're the ones that, behind the scenes, decide that he is the father, and he is in the army, or he is in the National Guard.
So yeah, so it's like, all this time later, they figure out how to return McGinty to his family. His fake family.
Yeah, I mean, this was a top-notch pairing, I thought.
Yeah, oh, I mean, so much more resonant than we thought it was going to be.
I would say this is one of the absolute best of Sturges. There's a lot more to come that are even better than this, but this is a great debut.
Critics were damned excited at the time.
Well, it is a great movie, but I think he gets even better with Christmas in July and the Bracken films and Sullivan's Travels.
Sure, and once he really...
Lady Eve.
Once he really unleashes his slapstick side, right?
Yeah.
And I mean, it has all of these really important autobiographical elements, and as well as Sturges' peculiar brand of social concern, both of which will be dispersed through his later films.
Yeah, it's social concern mixed with self-criticism, a kind of Protestant soul-searching to see if he's really concerned or is he just putting on an act and he's going to be revealed to be a phony.
Well, when
the people that he pretends he wants to help are going to see through him.
When you're as wealthy and completely out of touch with ordinary people as Sturges was throughout his entire life, if you do have any kind of social concern about America, you would hope that you would have some of those kinds of reflections about it.
Yeah, that's no discredit to him, right? That he's willing to examine his own impulses and try to see what is pure in them and what isn't, and maybe what matters in the end isn't what's pure and what isn't, but what makes sense and what can actually be done pragmatically. And of course, we're still wrestling with that question. I guess one last thing that we should mention, because it bears on The Way of All Flesh, is Louis-Jean Haidt seems like the movie is setting him up to actually go home and be reunited with his family as well. And he is the Tamiroff character here. He is the cashier.
Right.
Who has run for the border. And this movie says, no, don't do it. You should go home. If you have to go to jail for a little while, so be it. It'd be worth it.
But it's not available to the main character of this film.
Well, no, because he would be...
Who instead is living in this sort of Mulholland Drive alternate universe, right? Where he's leading a completely different kind of life, but with the same people.
Yeah, as restaurateurs. Now it's time for fear and movie going in Toronto.
So following our rule of podcast spontaneity, Dave, we have not talked at all about our reaction to the first two Kenyuo Tanaka films. What should be said about these? What's relevant about them? They both have scripts that were written by celebrated directors of the time, one of whom is still well known to Western audiences. So the first one, from 1953, Love Letter, was written by Keisuke Kinoshita,
who was the auteur behind the Setsuko Hara film Here's to the Young Lady, which we talked about and loved. It's a screwball comedy from the late 40s.
Yeah, it was co-written by him. I'm not sure if this is his regular screenwriter who is the co-writer. And then The Moon Has Risen has script by Ozu, and his screenwriter during the 1940s.
Right. So she comes out of the gates with some great properties. She's working with great actors, some of whom we've seen before, others that we're kind of meeting for the first time here.
This doesn't keep up. She doesn't just keep doing scripts by famous directors. She will later work with some female screenwriters. She only made 6 movies in total. This isn't going to continue, but this is how she gets started. There are 2 drastically different films stylistically. The first one is a melodrama, and the second one is a romantic comedy.
They both have a rich variety of moods and textures to them, I think. Both are quite funny, and both have some poignancy to them, I would say.
Yeah, I mean, these seem like movies that are... They look gorgeous. She has an extremely highly developed visual sense immediately, and visual competency. It seems like a lot of money was put into the movies. They seem to have a great familiarity and ease with the styles of classical realist Japanese cinema of the period, right?
And she's not just copying other directors' styles either, right? The Ozu film, the Ozu-written film, certainly has a lot of recognizable Ozu themes. It doesn't really look like an Ozu film.
In a lot of ways, it actually does.
No, it's much more wide open.
Okay. She is definitely borrowing visual motifs from Ozu, but she's also discarding a lot of his mannerisms.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, she's not making any secret of the fact that this is in dialogue with Ozu's films, but she is making it her own.
Do you want to talk about that one first then, even though we saw it second?
Well, we're not going to talk about either of them in too much depth, but yeah, we should talk about who's in them, what the basic story is.
The Moon Has Risen, although it's from a screenplay that Ozu co-wrote in the 1940s. Well, we haven't seen a lot of his 40s films, so we can't really speak to what his style is in the 40s. Of the films we have seen, including all of his Setsuko Hara films that we did for the Acturist Oeuvre review of her, this one reminded me most of Late Autumn, her last film for him, right? No, that's not her last film.
Well, there's one more after that, but that one is really, she's just got a small role in it.
Yeah, you really liked her role in that one, though, the final one?
I like all of her roles in all the movies, but Late Autumn is the one where she plays the mother, who has the daughter who everyone's trying to fix up, and they're trying to fix her up with people. There's a lot of matchmaking in it.
Yeah, well, the similarity is that it's a matchmaking story, explicitly, because that does show up in other of his films, especially his Setsuko Hara films, but it's very explicitly and openly a matchmaking story, and it's very meta about the formal qualities of romantic comedy, right? And so is this movie, even more so, even more abundantly. It also seemed like it might be indebted to Jane Austen's Emma.
A little bit. It certainly seemed like it. Yeah.
Did you notice that too?
Yeah.
The Ozu-Jane Austen connection? More so, like, Ozu is funny. Ozu's really funny. But this movie was laugh-out-loud funny throughout. I think it was funnier. Less quirky, more just funny.
Fewer evil kids.
Well,
none.
Well, except to the extent that the heroine has her dark side.
Oh yeah, but she's not an evil 8-year-old.
True. We've got a book on Tanaka to take a look at, but we haven't yet. Hopefully we will do that before we officially do her as part of the podcast.
Oh, well, we certainly will by 2028. That's when we're actually going to do our episodes on Tanaka. It'll be our second viewing, or maybe even third, because I'm really into these movies so far. I'll probably want to watch them again before then. We'll see.
I'm hoping that there will be some detail in that book about her methods, about the production history, about how much she might have altered the scripts that she was given.
Yeah, exactly. You have to figure there's going to be some of that. I don't want to delve into it until after we've seen the 6 films, because I don't want to get any spoilers or anything.
Anyway, The Moon Has Risen kind of reminded me, only in this one way, of Elaine May's Mikey and Nikki, in that it seems, just like that seems like the lost John Cassavetes film, this seems like getting another Ozu film, and yet they're also both completely different from those directors somehow. And this one was so interesting for how it shows you how important Ozu's screenplays are to his films, how he can actually work as a screenwriter without directing the film. But at the same time, there are these differences, as I said, and this movie seemed more content to be a comedy, and it works really well as that. And yet, a lot of the Ozu intensity is still present by the end.
Oh, yeah. No, it doesn't skimp on that. So it's not a light film, even though it's...
Yeah, I was waiting to see. I was waiting to see if she could get that intensity. I don't know if all the emphasis falls in the places it would for Ozu, but it's there.
No, it's very different, right? Because you do have Chichiryu.
You actually have...
In place.
You have the Tokyo story scene between the, well, essentially daughter-in-law and father. But that's not really... It's just like this very quiet afterthought. It's not the center of the... It's not the emotional center of the film. But it's there. It's present in the background.
So we won't say any more about it, but you should see it. It is a retrospective that's making the rounds. I mean, it didn't come first to Toronto. I know some people saw it in New York last year, and I think it's been to other cities. But if it comes to yours, it comes to your Cinematheque, make sure to go.
And yeah, and Ozu, the films we've seen, he never makes such a straightforward romantic comedy.
No.
I mean, maybe if we see his 40s films, we'll see more things like this, or maybe there's a reason he decided not to make it.
Right.
And gave it away for someone else to do something with it. Some part of himself that he needed to suppress and kind of maybe have as subtext rather than text.
Love Letter is a very different affair.
Yeah, this one was more reminiscent of something like James Whale's Waterloo Bridge.
Yeah, it really has a lot in common with that, and we're not going to talk about the ultimate direction of the story, so we won't give anything away there. It has its points of commonality and differences from that, but it is a very pointed examination of gender roles in post-war Japan, post-World War II Japan.
Right, and it's about a man and a woman who were in love with each other and are each grappling with the fact that she has had to put herself in sexually compromising positions during the war.
And he is part of this system that the women have been subjected to. He has no job either. We've got a lot of out-of-work translators in these movies.
Yeah, that's something that made me wonder about if she was contributing anything to the screenplays, because two completely different screenwriters, screenplays from different eras, presumably, but this theme comes up again.
Or it's just really prevalent.
A perpetual, I don't know. I don't know about post-war situation, because I don't know when the original Ozu script was written. But anyway, go on.
To get himself a regular gig, he runs into a friend who becomes very important to the story. I'm not going to give away why, but he has some pretty amazing scenes. It's a criminal enterprise that it basically is an adjunct to the grift that these women are forced to run on American GIs. They have no other source of income, and so they have to, when the GIs abandon them eventually and go back to America, they have to write letters to them, and obviously they have to write in English. They can't do it, so they get these translators to do it. So our high and mighty, morally judging man in this film, every day he writes letters for women exactly like the woman that he's been putting on a pedestal all these years.
Right.
And it just makes it all the more crushing, right? And so his hypocrisy and his own dissatisfaction with himself is just amplifying his anger that she couldn't remain pure for him.
Yeah, and of course that's very different from Waterloo Bridge.
Yes, and a lot more directly targeted at the gender regime as a whole. What it's doing to men and women.
Yeah, for sure. Although, as we said, it does have a screenplay written by a man, which has some very interesting elements, but I don't think you want me to go into any detail on this.
Well, it's Kinoshita, right? And one other thing that is similar from, you know, between this film and the other Kinoshita film that we saw, which is Here's to the Young Lady, is, again, we've got two brothers living together, and one brother is kind of blocked and unable to move on from his romantic idealizations of past times. I think that's an interesting symmetry there. I really want to see more Kinoshita films, and he's one who apparently at the time was just as big as the classical masters that we still celebrate, but he just has not come through with the same luster in the auteurist world that we now live in.
As we mentioned when we talked about Here's to the Young Lady, he was homosexual. He was known to be homosexual, so that makes another possible point of connection with Waterloo Bridge, but we'd have to know a lot more about him as a auteur before we could comment on that.
Well, hopefully we will one day. We'll have to devote some episodes to him in 2036. But I guess that's all we should say for now, except that, again, two major thumbs up, I think, from both of us for the films.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, good start.
And we'll talk about a couple more next time, because we've got movies on Friday, Saturday, and on Monday night, a totally different experience in the fear and movie-going sphere. It's going to be Les Enfants de Paradis, playing at the Paradise, So another...
Yeah, that'll be the first time we've been back to that theater since COVID.
That's right. Always good to see movies in the cinema. I guess one other thing we should say is that we did ask for suggestions last time out. If anyone could think of a Spielberg film that does center on an actor in the way that we enjoy. And we certainly enjoyed with a lot of the Daniel Day-Lewis films.
What we were saying was a film that integrally makes use of an actor's particular qualities and allows them to showcase them.
Yeah, and two of our finest interlocutors, Conrado and Adam, both came forth with Catch Me If You Can, a Spielberg film from the early 2000s that definitely seems to have played a role in building up Leonardo DiCaprio into the force that he is these days, and part of that transition period when he went from being the matinee idol to the substantial actor.
Yeah, and as I mentioned on Discord, I actually almost brought that movie up when we were having that discussion, because I remembered the discourse around it at the time being that it was this kind of breakthrough role for DiCaprio as an adult actor. And it does seem, you know, I haven't seen the movie since it came out, but it does seem like it could have laid the groundwork by having him play this con artist character, laid the groundwork for his probably best role in Wolf of Wall Street. Anyway, my favorite DiCaprio role.
The nature of this podcast, the way we plan ahead, it does preclude us putting Catch Me If You Can on our schedule in a substantial way anytime before 2036. But what I think Elise and I are ready to vow is that if it does come to a theater near us anytime soon, we will go see it.
You mean we will catch it?
We'll talk about it in a Fear and Movie Going segment. I'm sure it will happen. It seems like the kind of thing that will turn up at one of the many repertory theaters that have survived the COVID era.
Or maybe we actually will have to do a DiCaprio actor spotlight.
Yeah, I'm sure we will, but that won't be until the late 2030s. Next week on the show, we're getting into a new actorist overview. So it is Jean Arthur. Now, we did not go back to the very beginning of Jean Arthur's career. She starts in the 20s. If you see her from that period, she looks totally different. She sounds totally different. She just isn't Jean Arthur. And we kind of decided doesn't make sense to go back that far. We're not that obsessive about making sure that we see every movie, right? And we can't anyway. We've already missed a bunch because some of them don't exist.
Well, and we started cheating with Setsuko Hara because we can't see all of these films with English subtitles.
Right, exactly. For Jean Arthur, we arbitrarily or not so arbitrarily decided that 1934 was a good jumping off point for her. And we're gonna start out with Whirlpool and The Most Precious Thing in Life. I have not seen either of these films. I don't know if they're going to give us the fully formed Jean Arthur of the late 1930s or a transitional figure. We're going to find out together next week.
See you then.